Tonight, St. Lucians turn out in a huge show of support for the grieving family of Botham Jean. The Prime Minister rejects suggestions that the death penalty is an effective deterrent to crime. The United Workers' Party accuses the St. Lucia Labour Party of attempting to undermine confidence in the government. And Massey Stores renews its support for the breast cancer cause in St. Lucia for the 11th year. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polio. The chants "I stand for Botham" and "Justice for Botham" echoed throughout the Uranora International Airport today as the family of the slain 26-year-old Botham Jean returned to the island. School children joined relatives and members of the public in welcoming Botham Jean's mother, father and brother back home from Dallas, where he was shot and killed by an off-duty police officer in his own home. The family say they are overwhelmed by the massive show of support they have received from the public. DBS's Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage.
Family members say they are overwhelmed by the support shown not only in St. Lucia but across the globe. 26-year-old Botham Jean was shot dead in his Dallas apartment by a female police officer who mistook his apartment for hers. Uncle Ignatius Jean says such support is needed as the family continues its pursuit of justice and the efforts to ensure what happened to Botham does not happen to anyone again.
We'll continue to advocate for it, and I think advocacy always has some role in people crying out for justice, because today it is Botham. In the past we've had situations with the number of people in the United States, particularly of our race, and this ought not to descend into a racial matter. It is a matter about justice, whether you be black, white, blue, yellow or green.
One mother who has two sons in the United States came out in support of the Jean family and expressed fears that her sons may suffer the same fate as Botham unless things change.
I am here today because I have two sons in America, and I would not say I would want to be in the family's shoes, but I dread the day I would get a call. So in support of my children, those I have in America, then I choose to be here today to show support for the family.
I came here to support the Jean family, and as a St. Lucian and in solidarity with our other St. Lucians, I have come here in full support.
Students of the Beanfield Secondary School came out in large numbers with their placards. Teacher Anika Joseph says the students are very much aware of the situation and decided they wanted to come show support to the family.
For a lot of them, they're saying, you know, the police shot the man, miss. You know, you can see that they're outraged, and they consider injustice in it. You know, for them, it's another example of police brutality that they have been hearing a lot about. They feel very strongly about it.
Botham's mother, Alison Jean, emotional and overwhelmed, thanked the organizers for the homecoming and noted that justice for Botham must be kept alive.
I'm grateful for the support that I'm getting. We have to show America that Botham mattered, that Botham came from the country St. Lucia, and that St. Lucians are standing with me. I appreciate that. But I just do not want to sensationalize my child. Okay, I want him to die. He has died, and I want him to have his dignity in his death.
The chant "Justice for Botham" continued from the airport along the East Coast down to Castries, with supporters along the road wearing the national colors and red, which was Botham's favorite color. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
And Bertram Jean, the father of Botham Jean, joined the rest of the family in expressing his gratitude to St. Lucians for the overwhelming support during this difficult time.
It's unbelievable what I'm seeing there. It's overwhelming too. I had tears when I left the airport. I'm just thankful to and grateful to the people of St. Lucia for the generosity and the love that they just shown to our family. I'm just thankful and to the government and people of St. Lucia for being there to support us. We've had a long day yesterday with our lawyers just doing interviews at different television stations in Brooklyn, in New York, and so it's really tiring. But I'm sure the message is reaching out to the authorities in Dallas that justice should be served and will be served. And we are just amazed by what is going on in St. Lucia. I cannot believe that so many people has lined the street. We were not aware that any such thing was taking place. And we are just surprised for the support that we are receiving. It is just overwhelming, and I'm taking heart, but it's really a sad day for us, for my family. It just brings a lot of tears. But with the students and members of the body in Arkansas and the university where he studied, they were just there with us, and family from New York to help us, to strengthen us through in this period. Yeah, so it's a great sight in St. Lucia. All the kids who line the streets and just chanting Botham, justice for Botham, it really touches us.
Scores of St. Lucians turned out for today's homecoming. The streets were lined with supporters from VFO to Castries waving flags, something he says he will never forget. In spite of mounting homicide figures, Prime Minister Alan Shastin says he does not believe that capital punishment is the answer to the island's crime problem. In the past decades, many countries have abolished the death penalty, but some nations still execute people. Human rights group Amnesty International, which has been campaigning on the issue since 1977, says 141 countries have abolished the death sentence in law or practice.
While capital punishment is still on St. Lucia's law books, it has not been enforced for over two decades. Capital punishment is considered a UN rights violation, yet certain countries still carry out executions. The Prime Minister noted there are conflicting opinions on the subject, but says he does not think it is the answer.
I know that in St. Lucia it's very conflicted, and people think that it's the solution to a lot of the crime problems that we have. I am not one of those people that believes that capital punishment is going to solve those problems. I think that the problems that we have with crime and deviant social behavior is much more deep-rooted and requires a greater intervention.
It is for that reason, he says, the government is looking towards tackling the issue of crime in a holistic way. Similar views were echoed by National Security Minister Senator Hermenegild Francis, who also called for the island's judges and magistrates to enforce stricter sentences for firearm offenses. One recommendation, Mr. Shastner explained, is to improve the current justice system. For starters, having better courthouses.
I was very disappointed when I came into government, and you know this. The first thing I did is I offered the court system the financial center building. Right? That was the first thing that I did. And after months of showing how we could retrofit it and making the resources available, and I have to say to you, disappointing hundreds of workers who were expecting to work into that building, we were told that the justice system didn't want to go in. Then we looked at putting a temporary facility on Barnard Hill, and a project that started off at around $25 to $26 million. After everybody's intervention, ended up around $50 million. At $50 million, I have to say, okay, it's better to build a permanent building. We then solicited the private sector's involvement to build new courthouses, a Hall of Justice, and the price came in at $65 million.
Shastny noted that while justice is a priority for the government, it is the reason he says government is working so hard to build a new Hall of Justice. Joseph Solomon, who was convicted of rape and murder, was executed on 17th October 1995 with another prisoner acting as the hangman. It was the first execution in St. Lucia since 1986. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
On the political front, the governing United Workers' Party continues to express concern about what it says are attempts by the opposition St. Lucia Labour Party to undermine confidence in the current administration. To underscore its point, the UWP pointed to this week's letter from opposition leader Philippe J. Pierre, giving the Prime Minister a 60-day ultimatum to return to Parliament over a multi-million dollar deal with a local firm to undertake roadworks in the Prime Minister's constituency.
The UWP press release points to $15 million being spent on Makewood Roads and a further $13 million on the Larissos Road. It accuses the opposition leader Philip J. Pierre of failing to tell the St. Lucian people that these road projects were facilitated via design, build and finance arrangement, the same arrangement used by the Labour Party when in power to complete the Burns-La Hoche Road, a project totaling $29 million. But Pierre says that is beside the point.
We agreed that it was a design, finance, build contract. Our query is that since it is a loan, because the taxpayers are paying for the construction of the road, since the taxpayers are paying for the construction of the road, the representatives of the taxpayers, that is, in Parliament, have a right to know and to discuss that loan.
The UWP says while the signing ceremony to mark the commencement of the Burns-La Hoche project was held on Wednesday, January 7th, 2015 at Burns, the project was only taken to Parliament in July of that year. Pierre is disputing the claim.
The Burns-La Hoche Road was by international tender, formed from St. Lucia, Jamaica, and other places they tendered, and it came to Cabinet for discussion. That is why they could use the example of Guy Joseph in the Parliament. All we're saying, we advise the government to bring it to Parliament. That's it.
In a letter to the Prime Minister this week, the opposition threatened to take the matter to court if the Prime Minister does not go back to Parliament to receive approval. The Prime Minister responded to the ultimatum on Thursday.
With regards to the letter that I received from the Leader of the Opposition with regards to the financing of the project that took place in my constituency, that is with the AG's office, and the appropriate response will be sent to him at the time.
The UWP press release calls the threat by the St. Lucia Labour Party as simply a scare tactic. The UWP calls the threat an attempt at sabotaging progress in St. Lucia and for the SLP to score cheap political points. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Alex Bousquet.
Prime Minister Alan Shaston says he's confident that a vote of no confidence to put forward by the opposition SLP will not succeed. The move was announced by opposition leader Philip J. Pierre during a recent protest march organized by the Labour Party. Sheffield Gillard has more.
The plan to table a vote of no confidence against the UWP government was repeated at a September 12th SLP press conference. According to Pierre, the dissatisfaction with the government is not limited to the SLP membership. If the turnout at the September 9th march is anything to go by, he believes many St. Lucians share the Labour Party's displeasure.
We're going to bring a vote of no confidence to the government, and we're going to ask the government to defend itself on the indictments that we raise against them. And each of the 11 parliamentarians will have to stand up and defend the actions of the government.
Prime Minister Alan Shastney, while noting it's the opposition's right to table such a motion, also pointed out such motions hardly ever succeed. He says he remains unfazed by the opposition's tactics.
I'm confident that this would gain no success other than just trying to draw attention to themselves.
On June 7th, 1994, the administration of Prime Minister Erskine Sandford of Barbados Democratic Labour Party, DLP, was defeated in a parliamentary vote of no confidence when several DLP dissidents crossed the floor and sided with the opposition Barbados Labour Party, BLP, in criticizing a particular governmental appointment. It is unclear when the motion will be tabled. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Bousquet, and you're watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes. A notorious criminal from a small town finally got arrested. Immediately after that, he lost his hearing. How come?
Because he lost his court case.
He lost his court case?
Yeah.
He lost his hearing?
Yeah, he lost his hearing.
That one puzzled me.
Puzzled
you? Yes, it puzzled me well. Say that again.
A notorious criminal finally got arrested. But as soon as the police had him, he couldn't hear a thing anymore. He lost his hearing. How come?
He's confused. Confused. He's confused.
So that's what happened to him?
Yes, he's confused.
Thank you.
He's confused and he panic.
Yes.
Whenever you confused, you put your head gunny. You know that?
a notorious criminal, finally got arrested. But as soon as he got arrested, he lost his hearing. He couldn't hear a thing. How come?
I don't know. I know it's not his hearing he lost. He lost his hair ring, but I can't figure it out yet.
That's the lion he died. They are with the Isud, even Sudi. No, he left side Barton, because he sued. We decided on me.
A notorious criminal from a small town finally got arrested, and immediately after that, he lost his hearing. How come? Because the wages of sin is death. You've just been watching Friday Funnies on Street Vibes with me, Alex Busquet. Now near the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online at the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, the Taiwanese embassy reiterates its commitment to helping alleviate poverty on the island, and Massey Stores recommits to the fight against breast cancer. Welcome back to the DBS News World. The Taiwanese embassy here has reiterated its commitment to helping alleviate poverty on the island. At a brief ceremony at the Ministry of External Affairs yesterday, Ambassador Douglas Shen made a donation on behalf of the Taiwan government to the St. Lucia Social Development Fund, SSDF, to help with SSDF's poverty reduction efforts. Ambassador Shen said that social transformation is one of the fundamental avenues for a country to achieve sustainable development, and he was glad that Taiwan can contribute to the SSDF's mission to provide assistance to the St. Lucians in need. Minister for External Affairs Sarah Flood Bobra, who made a request for assistance on SSDF's behalf, expressed her gratitude to Taiwan for the generous donation and said that it will go a long way to help fulfill SSDF's mission to empower people, whether in terms of education, housing, or mentoring projects for disadvantaged boys. Massey Stores renewed its pledge to support the breast cancer cause in St. Lucia for the 11th year today. Unfortunately, one of the staples of the annual campaign, the Massey Stores Yoplait Cancer Walk, will not take place this year. The announcement was made at a press conference at Massey Stores Mega today.
The General Mills worldwide campaign came to an end about 3 years ago, but continued in the Caribbean. Now, in the 11th year of the breast cancer campaign, unfortunately, the Save the Lids to Save Lives is now discontinued in the Caribbean. This means that the Massey Stores Yoplait Walk will not be taking place this year. However, according to the division head of operations at Massey Stores St. Lucia, all is not lost.
Massey Stores now sees an opportunity to re-establish and develop new partnerships with friends in the fight to continue to help bring awareness and raise funds for women living with breast cancer. Massey Stores' mission states, creating value, transforming lives by caring for our communities. Therefore, in the absence of a Massey Stores-led cancer walk, Massey Stores will continue to be a force for good by supporting other existing entities who currently raise funds for women living with cancer. We believe that we can still achieve the objective of awareness and raising funds for breast cancer causes through in-store activities and collaborations with existing entities in their fundraising events.
The three entities which will be the beneficiaries of the fundraiser this year are the Faces of Cancer St. Lucia, the National Community Foundation, and the St. Lucia Cancer Society.
I really do not want to change the way in which we assist cancer people. I still intend to take them right through instead of giving them a lump sum and making them look for the rest. So we're hoping with our overseas link, we can work to work out something for our people so everybody will get a fair chance eventually at surviving cancer.
It is just encouraging that even if in the face of this that Mercy Stores has seen it fit to continue with the fight for cancer, because they could have chosen to just simply not do it. But they have continued it, and that cannot go unnoticed. And I want to say thank you.
And I hope as partnerships grow and things improve that there will not be enough space on that head table for all of the partners working together to try to eliminate cancer in St. Lucia. So I think ultimately that's our goal as a whole.
The press launch of the breast cancer campaign took place in the conference room at Massey Stores at Shock Bay. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
The Minister of Foreign Affairs of Cuba, Bruno Rodriguez Paria, received yesterday the Director General of the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States, Dr. Didacus Jules, who is in Cuba on a work visit. They discussed the historical relations of brotherhood that exists between the Caribbean and Cuba and expressed the will to continue strengthening the bonds of friendship and cooperation. They also agreed on the need to seek joint solutions to the problems that affect the region, such as the adverse effects of climate change, while exchanging insights and topics on the international agenda. Previously, the OECS Director General held a meeting with the Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs. Accompanying Dr. Jules were Jacqueline Emmanuel Flood, head of the Competitive Business Unit, and Bernadette Auguste, International Relations Officer. St. Mary's College recognizes excellence among its students. The details in just a moment. The St. Mary's College held its 18th annual awards ceremony this morning. This year, the awards ceremony was held under the theme, Success is not final, failure is not fatal, it's a courage to continue that counts. Alex Buske was in attendance.
The annual awards aim to inspire the young men to strive towards academic excellence and to develop into well-rounded students and future leaders.
Here at St. Mary's, we believe in lauding the boys when they accomplish good things, when they do good things, when they aspire to be different. And that's exactly the essence of our awards ceremony. We're having the ceremony under the theme, Success is not final, failure is not fatal, it's the courage to continue that counts. So we want to encourage the boys to always work hard and always give the best of themselves. In our society, we always want the boys to do well. We want the boys to do this, we want the boys to do that. But we don't tell them how to do it and we don't reward them when they actually do well. So our point here today, our purpose here today, is to really reward them and for the upcoming, the Form 1s, to let them see and let them have something to aspire to when they get to Form 3. Because this is basically a graduation from junior school to secondary, to senior school.
The awards were presented in various categories and included classroom awards, subject awards, the Spirit of SMC awards, and sports awards. Academic excellence awards were presented to students maintaining an average of 80% and above and who placed first, second, or third in their respective classrooms. Among the invited guests were former Governor General Dame Paulette Luizi and Acting Chief Education Officer Mrs. Rufina Charles.
Well, the Ministry of Education supports awards generally because awards are kind of motivation for students to do better. And I'm particularly pleased that the boys are being awarded because we would realize that from our, both from our national and regional standpoint examinations, that the boys are lagging behind. So these kinds of awards are there to help motivate them and for them to achieve some and feel some level of success. So I felt it important this morning for me to be here with them to share in their success.
According to Ms. Anios, the award scheme serves an important motivational function for students. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
The Grocery Vendors Association launched its scholarship program last evening. A ceremony hosted at the Grocery Municipal Building, Marina Street, Grocery, saw the presentation of three scholarships to students who have, despite all odds, succeeded at achieving a primary school level education and while moving on to secondary level.
The scholarship program is a first of its kind for the Grocery Vendors Association and is a way of the members giving back to the community they ply their trade in. It was also their way of honoring three small restaurant and bar owners from the community who are regarded as trailblazers in the community.
Because of the struggles and the commitment of the previous bar owners and vendors, our educational scholarship is a resource originally developed to fulfill a specific educational purpose for you. For you, you, and you.
Scholarships were presented to Dwayne Bertrand, Joel Felix, and Jaquan Charles. The three were encouraged to work hard and to always strive for excellence in and out of the classroom.
I really want to continue encouraging you guys to really put in the work, continue to be disciplined, continue to be focused, and then at the end of the day, there's nothing else that it will bring to you, because today I'm sure is a proud moment for you and your mom, and then continue to make them proud.
Students also expressed their gratitude to the association for the scholarships.
I'm the president of the association. Told my mom really the great news. I must say, she was even more excited than I have been. I have been guessing since then what it would be, and you do not want to guess the things we came up with. I am certain that the other parents and children had similar feelings. We are all very honored and thankful for being chosen, and we promise to continue to excel at each new level.
The association is hoping to make the scholarship initiative a permanent feature on its calendar of activities. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Sports is next when the DBS Newsworld continues. Finally from us, on the lighter side. A Chick-fil-A restaurant in Maryland shared photos of an unusual drive-through customer who placed his order while driving a large riding Land Mower. The Chick-fil-A in Frederick posted photos to Facebook showing an employee helping a drive-through customer named John Cook, who placed his order while driving his Land Mower. An employee was sent outside to help pass Cook his order as the mower kept him out of arm's reach of the window. When you're really craving that classic Chick-fil-A sandwich meal, the Facebook post said, along with a tractor emoji, our drive-through team is ready to serve you. And now, the usual reminder. St. Lucians turned out in a huge show of support for the grieving family of Botham Jean. The Prime Minister rejects suggestions that the death penalty is an effective deterrent to crime. The United Workers Party accuses the St. Lucia Labour Party of attempting to undermine confidence in the government. And Massey Stores renews its support for the breast cancer cause in St. Lucia for the 11th year. That's a broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night and see you next time.